Oh, good morning and hello to everybody joining us from many places all over Poland in this opening session of the Discover Canada contest. I'm speaking on behalf of the organizing committee of this educational project, which is a joint venture of the University of Silesia and Karol Miarka High School in Żory. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome all of you in this virtual opening session. I must say it's very unfortunate we had to cancel the semi-final as an in-person event at the University of Silesia. Well, thankfully, technology allows us to get connected in spite of COVID restrictions, and hopefully it will stay like this because we hear that today there are some issues. But we've got a plan B, so I'm sure the things will work out. It is the eighth edition of this contest already, and we are very glad that there is no waning of interest in it. We are convinced that many ideas originating in Canada and values represented by this country are very important in the 21st century and can be inspiring to anyone interested in building a better future. In this opening event, we are honored with the presence of Her Excellency Ambassador of Canada to Poland, Leslie Scanlon, who, in spite of her busy schedule, found time to be with us and to talk to the semi-finalists of this contest. We are very grateful for it. I would like to take this opportunity to express my utmost thanks and gratitude to the Canadian Embassy for the continuous and invaluable support of our various Canadian Studies initiatives. I also extend my thanks to the authorities of the University of Silesia, represented today by the Director of English Studies degree program in the Faculty of Humanities, Dr. Paweł Zakrajewski, whose support for this project has also been unflagging. Moreover, I thank the Director of Karol Miarka High School, Urszula Michalica, teachers involved in the contest, and Waldemar Socha, the President of Żory Municipality, who have been committed to this initiative since its very beginning. We have a short program for this morning session, starting with a welcome by Dr. Zakrajewski. The Q and question and answer session with Her Excellency the Ambassador will follow. And after this, there's going to be a pre-recorded lecture, pre-recorded due to time differences between Katowice and Toronto and fear of technical problems as well. Lecture delivered by George Eliot Clarke, one of the most distinguished Canadian writers and scholars of African and Mi'kmaq descent. Our semi-finalists are familiar with his work, as one of the essays they have been working on for the contest relates to his oeuvre. I'd like to close with extending my warmest greetings to the Discover Canada contest semi-finalists and their teachers, and to everyone attending today's virtual opening session. On behalf of the organizing committee, I offer my best wishes for success in this educational project. Thank you, and I'd like to, Dr. Zakrajewski to take over this digital space.
Professor, thank you. So I mean, you mean the Teams is mine, yes? So not the
Yes,
floor.
the Teams is yours. As you could say, the digital spaces, so this would be too, yeah, this would be colonizing
The is mine. Okay. Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody, and hello. I'm very grateful that I have an opportunity to support you, well, but also to open this fantastic event, which is again taking place, although virtually. I have a few reflections, right, concerning this event. First of all, I need to highlight that Discover Canada contest is next to the so-called English Language Olympics, which has been organized in Poland for over 30 years, is the second contest which gathers so many participants. But the second thing is that it's the second, well, I would even say the first contest. The first content contest, sorry, competition, which gathers students and, who are interested, devoted, and involved in cultural, life, political, literature issues, concerning a particular country. I would say that this contest is the one which really enriches our knowledge, fosters relations between the two countries. We are friends, so we foster our relations. And it also opens the minds of students to new horizons, because thanks to this, thanks to topics which are involved, which are presented here, thanks to the amount of knowledge you need to gain before you start, if you want to start, it simply makes your horizons, your brains open to the world. And I'm very grateful to Professor Sojka, Dr. Sempostavska, and Magister Madeja for giving your soul to this contest, for organizing it. And at the university, we all know how much you are involved. And that's really fantastic, because it's, as I said, the first cultural competition, I would say, in Poland, that is a kind of hallmark of our university, of the Institute of Literature Studies, Institute of Linguistics, and of course, English program. It's really a hallmark. And thank you so much for building it. Ms. Ambassador, thank you for the support. That's very crucial, because although, as you said, virtual relations, and you know, we are getting used to them. I simply hope that in future we'll meet in person, right, with students. We support hybrid learning, hybrid teaching, but some relations need to be in person. Ms. Ambassador, thank you so much for your support. Thank you for being with us, and thank you for giving us inspirations, because without the inspirations, nothing would be possible. The same goes to Karol Miarka High School. I'm really impressed that we still have high schools which get involved in the issue, in the matter, and support it throughout the whole project. Thank you to you, students. Thank you for coming. Thank you for participating. It's to all students, participants of the second stage. I know it's not easy. It's quite difficult. I read topics, right? Very inspiring, very intelligent, very, you know, fought over. And what I can do is I wish you the best of Canadian and Polish luck. So good luck. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Zakrajewski, for your input into this opening session. We'd like to move. I would request Ms. Ambassador to take over. Maybe just a brief introduction. Well, Her Excellency Ambassador Leslie Scanlon has had an illustrious career in the Government of Canada. She joined the Department of Global Affairs in 1990, yes, serves as a Director General in the International Platform Branch, as Director General of Consular Operations, and serves both in regional offices in Canada and overseas, like in Tokyo as a Trade Commissioner and in Paris as a Minister Counselor, Communication and Public Affairs. So just very brief. Thank you once again for joining us, for finding time to be with us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes. Yes.
I actually have a few written remarks, because I'm notorious at forgetting what I want to say. But I promise that when we get to questions, and hopefully there will be some, it'll be much more free-flowing. Friends, chers amis, drodzy przyjaciele. It's a great pleasure for me to join you today, as you are just in the finals of this year's edition of Discover Canada Contest. I want to greet all the participants and their hardworking teachers who are on the line with us. I want to thank you for your keen interest in my country and our cultures and our values. Though I must admit, we're all following the news, I am keenly aware of the challenges we are facing as a nation in the context of the protests at home. I would also like to thank the organizers of Discover Canada, the University of Silesia, and the Karol Miarka High School in Jordé for your unwavering support for the project. In particular, I would like to greet those without whose dedication the contest would not exist. Professor Paweł Zakrajewski, our longstanding friend, Professor Eugenia Sojka, and I remember so well my visit to Sosnowiec, and I'm so sorry I'm not there in person, Professor Sabina Svetasen and Rafał Madeja. We are very grateful for all of your efforts to develop and enhance the Discover Canada project since its inception in 2013, and I'm quite impressed that you have been able to carry on with it in spite of the challenges of COVID. The Discover Canada project is invaluable to us. I am delighted that so many young Poles are interested in learning about Canada and exploring our culture, our history, our politics, our geography. I am particularly happy that the contest is focused on cultural diversity and values such as the respect for rule of law and democratic principles, equality, social and cultural inclusion, and civic freedoms. I hope that the contest will ensure that a new generation of Polish youth gains a good and objective understanding of Canada. And I want to say that while I can't stay on the line to listen, I will tune in later to hear George Eliot Clark's remarks, the subject of which could not be more timely. What a terrific addition he is to today's event. So I want to congratulate you on a really terrific choice, and his topic is perfect. This summer, I leave Poland after 4 years as ambassador. I have traveled all over the country, both for personal and professional reasons, and I have met so many great people. But the one group that gives me the greatest hope is Poland's youth. As you make your own mark in the world and strive for the best possible Poland, I hope you will also become ambassadors for Canada. And I want to encourage you to continue to love your country, but look at Poland critically and strive to make it the best Poland it can be. Congratulations to all the participants for making it to the semifinals, and I wish you the best of luck. Bonne chance, Powodzenia. And now, is there anything you'd like to ask me about?
Okay, thank you, Ms. Ambassador. Yes, MST is open for questions. So anyone who has a question to Her Excellency is welcome. So please. Okay, I guess if someone is raising hand here. I guess. Okay, so what do I do? Okay, it's Piotr Waśków, I guess.
When you firstly arrived to Poland, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can, yes.
Okay, so when you firstly arrived to Poland, what did shock you the most in Poland? What was the biggest change that you could see between Canada and Poland?
I think a couple of you may have heard me say this before, but my first big shock, I think, was that walking down the street in Warsaw, people don't smile as much as they do at home. And I think that it's something you get used to, but when you first get here, people are more reserved here. And I think in Canada, we're more likely to smile if you're passing somebody in the street or you get on an elevator. Here in Poland, people are more reserved and they don't. And I've heard so many theories about why that is. But I was struck by that when I first got here. I was also struck by what a Western city Warsaw is. And when I met the mayor, Tuskowski, the first time, I said to him, you guys need to do a better job of promoting your city, because it's such a modern Western city with great architecture, restaurants, the history. And, you know, in Poland, I've taken the train all over the country. I've cycled all over the country. I've hiked all over the country. This country has so much going for it. And I feel like a lot of people, certainly where I come from, still view Poland in the past. And part of that, I think, is because our diaspora, our Canadian, we have about 1 million Polish Canadians. Probably a lot of that comes from their knowledge of their home country that is very dated now, because it's anchored in an old Poland. But I think I'd point to those two things.
Okay, thank you. Well, the students who are asking questions, I would appreciate that. We would appreciate if you turn your camera on, if it's possible. Okay, there's someone else raising a hand. Before asking the question, would you identify yourself, what high school you are from? Łukasz Magierowski.
Yes, of course. I'm from Liceum Ogólnokształcące Sióstr Urszulinek Unii Rzymskiej we Wrocławiu, so in Wrocław. a Catholic school in Wrocław. And my question is, do children in Canada know where Poland is?
Oh, I would say yes. I think geography is well taught. I'm not sure that history of Eastern Europe is taught as robustly, but yes, I think they would know where Poland is. And since you're from Wrocław, I hope you'll permit me a small story. When I was in Wrocław with some friends of mine from Canada, and it was pouring rain, we were staying at an Airbnb and we dug out garbage bags from under the sink to make raincoats because we didn't have any rain gear. And we were walking around the downtown of Wrocław, and Mr. Schetena, I'm not saying his name right, do you know who I mean? He's a political person here from Wrocław, Schetena. He was with Kidawa Wonska campaigning, and I saw him and I know him, and I said, hey, how are you? And he looked at me and he saw this person covered in garbage bags, and I forgot I was wearing garbage bags. And then I said, I'm the Canadian ambassador. and then I saw all the cameras and the big boom microphones, and I was like, oh my goodness. And he laughed, and he had Mrs. Kidawa Wonska with him, and we all had a good laugh about it. But I tell you what, I love Wrocław, what a great city. Thank you for your question.
Okay, I can see Victoria Płaziak is ready to ask a question.
Yes, hi, my name is Victoria Płaziak. I am from Pierwsze Liceum Ogólnokształcące w Krośnie in Podkarpackie Województwo. And I had a question regarding a TV series that currently airs in Canada. For years, people from countries like Syria, which are torn by war, migrated to Canada. And finally, after many years, their representation in TV has started to become more popular. But unfortunately, not enough that I could find discourses about the subject online. So what does the actual Syrian minority think about the TV series Transplant, which pertains to the life of a Syrian doctor who ended up in Canada and has finally started working at the hospital?
I've never heard of that show, I have to say, so I can't really comment on the show. But there are some very prominent Syrian refugees who are sponsored to come to Canada who have had very successful careers and who are very well known. Probably the most well-known is a fellow who ended up in Nova Scotia, and he created a chocolate company called Peace by Chocolate. And he now runs this big business employing all kinds of people. And he was privately sponsored, like so many of the refugees to Canada were. So a community sponsored him to come and for 1 year provided full support. But he's only one example. He gives part of his money to refugee and immigrant causes. He's just a great ambassador for the life that you can build yourself as a refugee in Canada. But I think you're right, though, that I've noticed in recent TV shows that you're seeing more colored people, you're seeing more diversity, more gay people, and it's all normalized. And I am noticing that when I'm seeing shows now. There's no special attention paid when you've got a couple that is whatever, diverse in some way, or people who are diverse. But it's fairly new here, just like everywhere else. That's to say here, when I say here, I mean Canada. But I think it's good to see things changing. But I'm sorry, I don't know the show you're referring to.
Okay, thank you. I can see Zuzana Dębska is ready to pose a question.
Yes. So, hi, I'm Zuzana Dębska from Liceum Ogólnokształcące im. Władysława Jagieły w Płocku. And my question is, what is the thing that you find most inspiring in your job?
Most inspiring in my job? You know, I get to meet the most amazing people in this job. I've met such a dynamic civil society here in Poland. And I have to say, I find that just so inspiring because, you know, you're obviously Polish, you read the news, there are a lot of negative things happening in the world. But that's been difficult with COVID, because when I come here as a diplomat, I spend 4 years here. And when 2 years of that I'm not able to travel, it really reduces our networking and our meeting in person. But I work with so many great people in civil society. And I have to say, that's probably inspired me the most, to see that there's so much talent and dynamism and intelligence in the people I work with here in Poland.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, the next post, I don't know if it's, I can identify it as a person. It says Wojkowice, I guess Wojkowice High School. There's someone from the high school who wants to get into this discussion. So please do post the question.
I'm Mateusz from ZSOIT Wojkowice. So What's the hardest task in your position?
Well, that's easy. The hardest thing is when you have to send people home to Canada if there's a crisis, like at the beginning of COVID, or, you know, anytime there's a crisis, it affects the personal lives of your staff. And that's everybody, including our locally engaged staff and their families, all of our families. Managing COVID has been very difficult because we've been trying to continue to operate while keeping everybody's well-being in the absolute top of the priority pile. So, sorry, somebody's not muted. I can't.
Yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. So what do we do? What do we do just to mute?
So I've unmuted myself. That's good. You muted everybody, I think, so I'll unmute myself. I have to say, now I'm getting, sorry. So I was getting bounced back. I think that's the hardest thing that as an ambassador, obviously, there are difficult things you have to do, like if you disagree with the government of the country that you're in, if you have differences in values or differences in approaches that are can be quite emotional and quite difficult. But I think the personal side of being a manager, and it's true of any one of us who's managing a team, it's difficult if you have to make decisions that affect the personal lives of your colleagues.
Thank you. Paweł Januszak. Yes, it's the next student who would be interested to talk to Ms. Messer.
Hello, I'm Paweł Januszak from the 9th High School of Cyprian Kamil Norwidii Częstochowa. And my question is, what do you like the most about your job?
Well, I think I said it about the meeting all the great people in Poland. I've also had the chance to travel all over the country, and I cover Belarus as well. It also gives profile. Like, I think being a woman, it gives profile to women in leadership. And I really like, we have a group of about 20 female ambassadors, and we try to do things as a group of women that are in leadership roles. When I was presenting credentials to President Duda, I asked if I could bring my son, who was under 18. He was 16, and you're not supposed to bring underage kids. But I thought for my son to see his mother present credentials to the president of Poland. And in Poland, they do this wonderful ceremony when you're presenting credentials. And I thought it normalizes for him that his mother, a woman, is in a position of leadership. And I think I like that very much about being a female ambassador, is that we're able to really demonstrate women in leadership in so many ways. And I think I like that a lot.
Okay, Nicole Wałach is the next one here on my list.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So my question is, when you're traveling through Poland, no matter the reason, was there any Polish food that was your favorite?
Polish what?
Polish food.
Haha, Polish food. Well, I have to say, I have a terrific chef. Whoops. I'm running out of power on my phone, so I'm just going to put my plug in. Okay. Can you still hear me?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Sorry, I had a bit of a problem there. I'm gonna go sideways in a minute because I hope the phone doesn't fall over. Whoa, it's moving. This minute, I'm going to see if I can juggle it. I have a wonderful young Polish chef, and while his focus, of course, for official hospitality is Canadian food. Whoa. Sorry, this is my ad hoc setup here. Having it plug in so I don't lose power is, now I'm just going to be a little bit crooked anyway. But he makes the most amazing pierogi, and he makes the most amazing clear beet soup. So not like a borscht, like I would normally know from, I've lived in France several times, but a clear soup. I don't know what kind of spicing. It's fantastic. But I have to say, my daughter and I bicycled from Warsaw to Sopot over 4 days a couple of summers ago. And we had the most wonderful local food everywhere we went. We'd go and find out what was local to that area, because Poland is one of those great countries that has regional food. And so we took advantage on our travels of trying everything we could that was local. But I have to say, because Kamil, our chef, makes the most amazing pierogi, that's the big, I know it sounds a bit stereotypical, but that's the big memory I have of my favorite Polish food.
I'm not sure if it's Victoria, but there are more questions. Victoria Płaciak, well, we had here already. Okay. Is there someone?
Sorry.
Victoria Płaciak?
Yes. Sorry. In countries like in Poland and in the USA, lately there have been many movements which have caused like banning of several books in schools. Usually these movements want to like hide the history of minorities in Poland and in USA. What steps are being taken in Canada to prevent this thing from happening? Also, you have a very cool hat on the wall. I had to point that out.
That's my red cowboy hat. Yeah. in Canada, I have never heard of anyone trying to ban a book. So I don't know what measures we have in place. We just wouldn't do it. I think it's a terrible practice to get into, especially the books that have been banned recently. It's a very bad thing to be banning books. I mean, the bar on something mm-hmm. like that for hate speech reasons would have to be very high for any book to meet the threshold of being banned, personal opinion. But in Canada, I've never seen it come up. So, I would assume that there might be rules, but it would be a huge freedom of speech problem if someone tried to, I think.
Okay, I guess we've got a student from Bojkowice High School again. So please.
Second question, what's your favorite Canadian dish?
My favorite Canadian dish? Oh my goodness. Thing is, I love to eat, so I pretty much love everything. Okay, my mother makes an amazing apple pie. So I think food for me comes down to also to who made it. So I really like our chef, so that helps me like his food. But my mother makes an amazing apple pie, so maybe I'll say apple pie. Well, there you go, I'm falling off again. Sorry.
Kacper Kremiec has a question.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes, you can.
My question is regarding the Polish demographic problem. Our population is decreasing right now, and the best solution seems to be immigration, but our public is discouraged to this solution. So what would be your advice how to encourage?
Well, I think I know that there is a tendency amongst young people in Poland not to be interested in going into politics, but they are interested in activism, is what I'm understanding when I speak to a lot of civil society representatives. I think for issues like that are fundamental to the future of a country, engagement from young people, engagement from anybody. I think that we all have to be engaged with our country if we see issues that we believe are impacting on the quality of life and freedom and equality in our country. So I would say to you that if you feel that this is a problem, it would be a good idea to get involved somehow with the local organizations, with NGOs, with local government. Get involved. And I know that there's a tendency to not want to go into elected politics, but if you're not in elected politics, somebody has to be in elected politics to make a difference. So that's what I would say. I think the answer is to get involved. Sorry, Mike, I'm still here. You can go to the next question, but I think there's a problem with my plugin.
Just a second.
Okay, sorry. And this is probably the last question because I have to run. I have to go to the embassy. Yeah. As you know, a lot's going on in the region. I've got something at 11, but.
I don't know whether there's this question from Wojkowice again.
Hello, I'm Magda Waluga from Wojkowice. And okay. I have a question. Do you know any Polish song that you like?
Polish song?
Yes.
No, I don't. I used to, when I got here, I used to listen to Polish radio my first year, and I heard a lot of music, so I recognize some of it. But when I'm in the car with the driver, he tends to listen to a station that plays American hits. So I've been to see wonderful classical concerts here. So I guess if I had to pick anything, it would be some of the mazurka, or maybe there's some beautiful music. I know the classicals better than I know modern.
Okay. I know you're very busy and you need to go to all your other duties, but I wonder if I could ask a question, but I mean, this could probably require a long answer, because during your term, well, we hear that you'll be leaving us soon. There were certain priorities of the Canadian government that, well, you as an ambassador was involved in. So which of these, which of the duties or actions or the work that you've been doing you found most, no, what does she want to say, most important, but crucial, okay, for this, for the Canadian priorities, Canadian government priorities, and your involvement here in Poland?
I think that's an easy one for me. We consider human rights to be one of our top priorities, and for Canada, everybody is equal. And I think our biggest file on LGBT is on human rights is LGBTQ. And I, from what I know of my work in Poland, that is the one file that has meant the most to the Poles that we've worked with. Having visibility from ambassadors, from embassies of Polish people who are trying to advocate for a better Polish society. This is not us coming in telling Poland what to do. These are Polish people who want support for initiatives and for activities that they feel are important. And for Canada, we feel very, very strongly about, you know, love is love. It doesn't matter who you love, you shouldn't be judged. And so this is something we spend a lot of time on and we care a lot about at the embassy. And I think we've been very visible. I've gotten lots of feedback over my time here. That's probably been one of the highest visibility activities I've been involved in.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. We really appreciate that you joined us. And well, express my thanks and gratitude for everything you have been doing for us. So thanks, and we wish you all the best
in your future endeavors. Have a great morning. So good to see you all, even though it's virtual. Take good care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. So we are moving on to the next point on our agenda, which is going to be the lecture by George Eliot Clark. And Magister Madeira is going to have a brief introduction. So, you know, the Teams is yours, right?
Good morning, everyone. Our keynote speaker today is Professor George Eliot Clark. He's a poet, he's a novelist, playwright, and a critic. He was born in Nova Scotia and grew up in Halifax. He's a seventh generation Canadian of African American and Mi'kmaq descent. His mother's ancestors arrived in Canada as American slaves liberated by the British in the War of 1812. Currently, he is a professor of English at the University of Toronto. His work reflects his interest in the Black culture of Atlantic Canada, an experience and identity he describes as Africadian. It is a term he coined to describe the descendants of Black United Empire loyalists who came to the Maritime Provinces in the 18th century. He has been exploring the cultural and social histories of Black Canadians across various genres, braiding together personal experience and archival research. He is the author of many works, such as the verse novel Wyla Falls, librettos for the operas Beatrice Chansey, the novel George and Rue, as well as many critical and scholarly works such as Odyssey's Home, Mapping African Canadian Literature. Clark is also the recipient of numerous honors and awards for his work, such as the Governor General's Literary Award for his poetry, the Canadian Parliamentary Poet Laureate, the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Achievement Award, the Pierre Elliott Trudeau Fellowship Prize, the Planet Africa Renaissance Award, and the Order of Nova Scotia. Today, he is going to deliver a lecture titled Lessons on the Handling of Democracy-Destructive Canadian Crisis by Two Closely Related Trudeaus. So I believe the floor is his right now.
So this is a very topical... It's a very topical lecture, thinking of the situation in Canada currently, the state of emergency in Ontario. Professor Clark attached a fragment of his play on Trudeau's libretto, actually. This was also sent to you. So if you had this text at hand, we would appreciate this, because in one section of this lecture, he's reading some fragments of this particular fragment. Also, because we've had some technical problems, and we wanted to show the lecture, it's a pre-recorded lecture, as we've as I've mentioned before, on the MS Teams, but we needed to have a plan B. So this lecture will be streamed on YouTube, right? I mean, there is a link we give to you, so we would appreciate that you just connect to this YouTube version, let's say, of this lecture. It's half an hour. After this, we return to well, we'll be on MS Teams. We do not disconnect. It's just the question of watching it in a better version, let's say, than the one that we happen to have on MS Teams. So after this, we return, and there'll be more information about the contest details related to your writing and to the test. So now the lecture by George Elliot Clark, we wish you a good listening experience, and we'll enjoy the lecture by one of the writers you have been prepared to in terms of writing an essay, because you've worked on a number of texts that we suggested for this competition. We were very happy that George Elliot Clark agreed to give this lecture. So here it is.
Hello, I am so glad, so honored, so privileged to be able to address you in terms of your great interest in Canadian culture and history and politics and literature. It means a lot to me as a Canadian writer that you, students in Poland, from all across Poland, are interested in my culture, my country, and my own particular personal perspectives on it. Of course, as you might be able to tell by looking at me, I don't share the same complexion as the majority of Canadians. I am an African Canadian of seven generations stance, I suppose, here in Canada. My roots go back to the War of 1812 on my mother's side, and to the very late 19th century on my father's side, but both parents' ancestors ended up in Nova Scotia. And so I am part Black, that is to say African-American in my heritage, and also part West Indian on my father's side from Jamaica. And I'm also part Indigenous, and I call myself Afro-Métis, because my mother's ancestors are also descended from a Cherokee woman. And the reason why that's possible is because during the War of 1812, the Cherokee were allied with the British. And so as the British freed and removed African Americans from the United States to colonial British North America, what is now Canada, so did Cherokee and other Indigenous people also come to Canada, and specifically to Nova Scotia, along with African Americans. So I've got a long history in this country, and I do love it. I'm very much a patriot. And at the same time, I continue to be critical of Canada, because I do see it as being a society that is based on hierarchies of class and race and ethnicity and language and religion. So despite the fact that it is a democratic country, despite the fact that we have great civil liberties that I enjoy very much so as a writer and an intellectual and professor of English at the University of Toronto, I am still critical of the fact that my country, Canada, is built upon the idea and started out in 1867 based on the idea that some Canadians were better than others. And I still think that there's a residue of that negative attitude here in my great country, which I love very much. And it's something that I often complain about in my critical writing, my scholarship, as well as in my creative writing, which is primarily poetry. Even though I could give you a lecture today on matters of race and racism and so on, which is something that concerns me deeply, and something I've often commented on, right now in Canada, we've been going through the last couple of weeks a period of turmoil because some of my fellow and sister citizens have decided that having the right to vote and the right to change the government democratically and peacefully is not good enough, that their need to express their disfavor with the health measures, public health measures, that have been put in place to keep us safe or to keep our numbers of sick or dying to an acceptable minimum, keeping in mind that no minimum is acceptable, but the lowest minimum is going to be more acceptable than the highest maximum, let me put it that way. But in any event, these citizens who decided to protest against public health measures have effectively blockaded important transit points, international border points between Canada and the United States, are therefore causing great harm to the economy, and also disrupting civil discourse and governance itself. Because of this ongoing crisis in Canada, I've been moved to reflect upon Pierre Elliott Trudeau. His son, who was born on Christmas Day, 1972. In fact, I remember his birth because I am 12 years older than the Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau. So I was 12 going on 13 when he was born. So I remember it. But anyway, to get to the point, I've been thinking in the last few days about the contrast between father and son, Trudeau Pierre and Trudeau Fils, in terms of the handling of the current crisis. So I was moved to go back to this book of mine, which was published in 2007. It's actually a play. It's a play in poetry. It's also an opera, which has been produced a couple of times in Canada. And the title of this book is Trudeau, Long March, Shining Path. And it's my critical reflections in a creative way and playful way on the life of Pierre Elliott Trudeau. And I want to begin my discussion of Trudeau. And the reason why I am talking about him again is because I'm thinking about what it means to be a citizen of this country. How should we appreciate our civil liberties? And how should we protest? And I think that the life and career of Pierre Trudeau, who actually undertook many protests himself in his time, asks, or rather suggests, some instructive contrast between the Canada of the 1960s and 1970s and our current situation, which I think unfortunately reflects a relative Americanization. Let me put it this way, the Republicanization, in terms of the Republican Partyization of the old Progressive Conservative Party of Canada. So, but I begin my talk by reading from this book, Pierre Trudeau, in Vion Rose, A Life in Pictures, and so on, and basically pictures as in woodcut illustrations. And here's a picture of Nixon meeting Mao, just so you can see what it is I'm actually reading from. But both Justin Trudeau and myself introduced this book when it was published in November 2015, just before Justin Trudeau won election. So I begin by talking about Trudeau with this book. Like George Walker, the great woodcut artist whose illustrations fill up this volume, I'm a child of the 1960s, and so my political and intellectual vision has been shaped by the fashions of thought and purpose that Pierre Trudeau brought to his premierships 1968-79, 1980-84. It was impossible to avoid his influence. The politician who comes alive in the pages of this book was certainly not like any other before or since, to strut into the House of Commons or dance into 24 Sussex Drive. He was unprecedented. He remains singular. Charismatic, photogenic, quick with a quip, and flexible in pose, posture, and style, he seemed as utterly at ease in his own skin as he was in buckskin or in a tuxedo. His character appeared dramatically un-Canadian, unlike his predecessor, Prime Minister Lester B. Pearson, who survived two minority parliaments. He was no master of compromise. Perhaps the big difference between Pierre Trudeau and other prime ministers is that he came to politics not merely from law offices or a career in business, but from the intelligentsia, the Quebec bilingual elite that was grappling with critical issues in the modern era, the relationship between the citizen and the state, the strife between capital and labor, the conflict between rights and rules, law and liberty, and of course between cosmopolitanism and nationalism. Trudeau became a politician after brooding over the Canadian Constitution and after advancing his ideas through both civic action and journalism. Indebted more to Montesquieu than to Marx, Trudeau's essays remained lively and insightful six decades later because he refuses compromise and rejects ambiguity. In those essays in the 1950s, Trudeau wants Quebec to become an open society so we can breathe freely. He wants liberty. So when Trudeau began to be visible to English Canadians in the mid-1960s, he was fresh from frontline battles in Quebec for more democracy, more liberty, more economic progress. He knew that politics wasn't just about secret handshakes, but about the public implementation of progressive dreams. He had traveled further, literally and metaphorically, than likely any other Canadian politician of his time. He had seen and studied how other people lived and how they had chosen to arrange their societies and assert their cultures. Certainly, his youthful flirtation with anti-Semitic fascism, a common malady of Quebecois intellectuals, rejecting communism as a panacea for Anglo-Saxon imperialism and robber baron capitalism, had been educated out of him at Harvard University and the London School of Economics, and confirmed by his backpacking tour of the globe in 1948-49. That latter experience, during which he witnessed the birth of Israel and the struggles of India, Pakistan, and China to emerge from centuries of Western imperialism, exploitation, and oppression, also rendered him a man modernist in education, but postmodernist in orientation. Trudeau's journey made him an internationalist individualist. Thus, he was prepared to let 100 flowers blossom, 100 schools of thought contend in the mode of multiculturalism socially and in the mode of the thousand channel universe technologically. In other words, he became a forerunner of diversity, himself adopting sandals here and a turban there to affirm the ultimate unity of human experience. Apart from the personal education gleaned from his travels, Trudeau was shaped above all by the energies released as French Canadians in Quebec began to conceive of themselves as Québécois and to express a desire to replace Anglo-Saxon capitalists with their own Francophone bourgeoisie as the legitimate governors of La Belle Provence. This process is now called the Quiet Revolution, and its purpose was encapsulated in the 1960 Quebec election slogan of the triumphant Liberal Party, Devenons maîtres chez nous, let's become the masters of our own house. Trudeau feared that the once insular Quebec would become an aggressively nationalist state, suppressing minority rights. He envisioned a federalism that would allow Francophone-majority Quebec to develop itself via the powers granted provinces under the Constitution, while the federal government protected Anglo language rights in Quebec and asserted French language rights across the rest of Canada. And if Francophone Quebecers could be persuaded to participate in the governance of Canada as a whole, they would be less likely to focus their energies on becoming the founders and leaders of an independent and perhaps myopically nationalist Quebec. The best example of Trudeau's argument was, of course, himself. To my mind, the greatest revolutionary change brought about by Trudeau is that he introduced English-Canadian culture and politics to hitherto invisible but transformative figures from French literature and Quebecois culture, the flâneur, the boulevardier, the chevalier, the absurdist, the existentialist, the prankster, the situationist, the negre blanc, the hipster, the picaro, the Don Juan, but also the Renaissance man of quotable scholarship, artistry in letters, athletic prowess, wilderness adventure, and daring do. When English Canada began to notice Trudeau between 1965 and 1968, and really to fall in love a bit with his image, the timing was right. Expo 67 suggested that Canada was actually sexy, sophisticated, and exciting, not only a land of plaid-jacketed lumberjacks and pipe-smoking fishermen. And Trudeau was a one-man world expo, being bilingual, cerebral, a with-it globetrotter, and an outdoorsman. But he was also a decent Canuck answer to the glamorous and globally mourned American president, John F. Kennedy, assassinated on November 22nd, 1963. So debonair and Cold War chivalric was Kennedy, with his Rat Pack cronies, Camelot brain trust, and Parisian stylish first lady, that Canadians could only look on with audible envy. Trudeau's entree into Canadian national politics proved that we could have a Kennedy all our own, and one who could date Barbara Streisand and Leona Boyd, and hang out with Mao Zedong, Marshall McLuhan, and Fidel Castro. What really made Trudeau unique in his time is that he seemed to be the politician best informed about the process of decolonization occurring in Quebec, as well as in much of the rest of the world that had formerly been controlled by Britain, France, Spain, Portugal, or the Netherlands, or more recently, the United States. His answer to the radical wing of Quebec's decolonization was eminently Canadian, a rewriting of the British North America Act of 1867 to emphasize rights, freedoms, and the powers of people versus governments. The 1982 patriation of the Constitution and its revision as the Canada Act, with an entrenched Charter of Rights and Freedoms and an amending formula overriding provincial objections, particularly from Quebec, represented Trudeau's historic political accomplishment, if resolutely apolitical, in the sense that it answered provincial demands for greater powers and more autonomy with an appeal to reason over passion. Constitutional reform, not popular revolution, was, for Pierre Trudeau, the way forward. Personally, I wish that Trudeau had better understood the aspirations of the First Nations to realize greater prosperity, dignity, and equality. By the time he had begun to acquire that vision, however, he was no longer an empowered politician, but a statesman, returning to editing a revived Cité Libre, his journal of ideas that he first edited and operated in the 1950s, and took up again a battle against Philistinism, not with legislation, but with essays tinged with poetry. I'll shift from this work to my play in poetry, Trudeau, Long March, Shining Path, address again my concerns for rights and the powers of people versus governments in the context right now of a great deal of I think, relatively artificially promulgated civic unrest. I read some portions of this play in response. And again, it's also an opera with music composed by the great maestro D.D. Jackson, whose own genealogy or biography is closely tied to the dream of multiculturalism that Pierre Trudeau represented and extolled and expounded, because D.D. himself is the son of two immigrants to 1960s Canada. His father is an African-American professor emeritus in Spanish from Carleton University in Ottawa. And his late mother was a translator of Spanish and French, but was actually from China and arrived first in Mexico as the daughter of the Taiwanese ambassador to Mexico, and then ended up studying Spanish at a college in the United States where she met Dee Dee's dad. And of course, as I just mentioned, they both ended up settling in Ottawa. And also I should say that Dee Dee's mom was also one of the primary persons to put in motion official bilingualism as a practical act in 1969, after it was actually passed as official legislation and so on. So I begin by showing this a very famous photograph. This gentleman over here is Lester Bowles Pearson, Nobel Peace Prize recipient for his actions in resolving the Suez Crisis of 1957. So he was Canada's 14th Prime Minister since Confederation 1867. Standing next to him is Jean Chrétien, who of course later became Prime Minister in his own right. Standing next to Jean Chrétien is John Napier Turner, who also became, unfortunately for him, a very short-term prime minister in basically the summer of 1984. And then, of course, the man of the hour in terms of my book, and that, of course, is Pierre Elliott Trudeau, who was Canada's 15th prime minister. Anyway, want to address, first of all, notions of multiculturalism and flirtations with left-wing politics and so on. And so I share with you this scene, and this play slash opera is supposed to be humorous, and I do take liberties with time frame and so on. So anyway, here it is. Act two, scene one, Havana, Cuba, April 1960, and it's Trudeau hanging out with Castro, Fidel. So Castro begins and he says, "Senor Trudeau, ahoy! Sings Havana, magically you've canoed from Florida like a guerrillero. How brave you solo, shooting shark-jawed waves." And then he says, as an aside, "Here's a man built of blood, not martinis. His study's dusty, he wafts up woods and seas." And then Castro says, "Lieutenant Neruda, a round of rum." And Neruda says, "Trudeau, knock back only our blackest rum." So they're all drinking rum now. Castro says, "Love this lacquered, lustrous blackness." And Neruda says, "This blackly black, blackest blackness." And then Trudeau says, "Viva Cuba, el pueblo cubano." And then Castro says, "Viva la amistad cubana, canadiense." Everybody drinks. Trudeau says, "This April 1960, Senor Trudeau." Sorry. Trudeau says, "This April 1960, Senor Castro, I had to see. Your revolution, it excites. Quebec's is just too quiet, like kites." Neruda says, "Yet Quebec's revolt rears a score, visual of Le Negre du Nord." And then Castro says to Trudeau, "Maybe you're just some playboy militant, a dilly-dallying, shilly-shallying dilettante." And Neruda says, "Or a groupie to Cuba's jubilant liberation, or a tourist ogling Caribbean tribulation." Trudeau says, "For myself, I just had to see why Cuba so riles the Yankee." Castro says, we drive America crazy, drive Yanks crazy because we drove the mafia back to Miami. Neruda says, we cashiered casinos and gave poor Cubans cash. Trudeau says, that was rash. Neruda says, brave. Castro says to Trudeau, do you like the rum, the cigar? Trudeau says, it's exquisite, famous, five star. Castro says about Diefenbaker, who was the sitting prime minister, I like your prime minister who scares television and U.S. ears. Trudeau says, you mean Diefenbaker? He's fine. He backs a Bill of Rights I'd sign. Castro says, he looks a sorry sight and speaks such big words, his big head shakes. Neruda says, Senor Trudeau, you aren't a Marxist. Trudeau says, I like Groucho Marx. Neruda, be serious. And then he says, nah, Bakra, white boy, you ain't black. You're just another gringo out of Quebec. Decide now whose side you're on. Trudeau says, I'm on the outside, unless I've got a girl at my side. Castro says, Pierre, you're one brash bourgeois hombre. Trudeau says, Fidel, I'll down one more Cuba Libre. Trudeau holds up his glass, Castro pours. Then Castro says, in Harlem, I met Malcolm X, that black Islamic intellect. We agreed we poor need atom bombs all our own, so profiteers and parasites get overthrown. And then Trudeau says, the Canadian genius is no army defines us. And then Castro guffaws. He says, the U.S. Army affronts Canada just as it confronts Korea. And Neruda says, if Kennedy troops here, he dies under our boots and machetes. And he picks up a machete and he waves it around. And Castro says, gracias, Lieutenant Neruda, bid our boss cook broil barracuda. So Neruda departs, and Trudeau and Castro light up cigars. Trudeau says, it's good to swill your rum and smoke your cigars. Castro says, we'll skin dive flush with rum under light plush stars. Trudeau says, surely you must conduct the state. And Castro says, we'll clean machine guns, Soviet. So they pick up their machine guns, and Trudeau picks up one and aims it. And Castro smiles approvingly. And he says, let peacenik's puff of beatnik love I trust in my Kalashnikov. Neruda runs back and he salutes Castro. Neruda, Yanks attacking the Bay of Pigs. We're whacking them. They dance death jigs. And Castro says, if they want war, the day will dawn, and we will hang each Yankee son, and all imperialists face purge, making New York new Nuremberg. Trudeau, once disaster starts, there's no end. Corpses pile up, maggots unbend. The stink and rot appall all screech. Set fire to our dead. Smoke shrouds speech. Castro, serve Kennedy and Austerlitz in the swamps of the Bay of Pigs. Neruda, repair that gross monstrosity, fix insolent pomposity. Castro, all power flows from the barrel of a gun. Neruda, all power flows from the barrel of a gun. So they go off to fight the Yankee invasion at the Bay of Pigs. And then Castro shakes hands with Trudeau, grabs the machine gun, dons a helmet, runs off stage with Neruda, and there's a sound of gunfire in the distance. And then Trudeau stretches out on a lounge chair and continues to smoke his cigar and swig his rum. And then he says, who is shooting whom? Why? What for? In history's fog and ice cold war. And so the purpose of that scene is to suggest that he was somebody who was interested very much so in peaceful resolutions to all sorts of conflicts and working through democratic means. At the same time, when we had a crisis in Canada, the October crisis in 1970, Pierre Trudeau, when requested by the government of Quebec to put in place the War Measures Act as a response to the destabilization of the government of Quebec at the time, he did so with great regret. But nevertheless, he made the argument that it was important to defend democracy. And even though one can argue with that, always argue with that idea, there is, I think, some truth in it, nevertheless. And so in this scene about the October crisis and Trudeau's response with the War Measures Act, I have him say these words. Facing these villains, don't hold back, pacify them by sneak attack. Blitzkrieg like Mao and Genghis Khan, maneuver like crack, Napoleon. Break skulls as if at Austerlitz, fight like Castro at the Bay of Pigs. I'll not quake under terror's awe, but reinforce the force of law. Chasten Beretta and Beret, bandits, collapse their cabaret. And he says to a reporter, reporters, when will you stop scheming up nightmares from ink and scotch? Whatever I defend, whether black or white, not one of you feels I'm ever right. Damn you, I'll grind these gangsters down alone. I'll confound what you condone. Just watch me, I'll bulletproof democracy. Rough up ruffians, bash these brutes, flay their bones for drumsticks and flutes. Butchers who strove hard to blackmail our state will taste exile and jail. And I have to pause there because I think I've hit my half hour mark. I will apologize for being so serious today in my remarks, but I do think that intellectuals, scholars, writers, artists do have an obligation to speak about current crises and passing affairs of state, which may have grave consequences. And I hope not. I hope everything will be settled resolutely, peacefully. But at the same time, it is important that those of us who have the ability and occasionally a chance to speak in favor of democracy, which means equal rights, liberty, justice for all, take every opportunity to do so, especially at moments like this. So thank you so very, very much for your attention. I wish you all the very, very best in your study. Thank you for being so interested in Canada. It is a great country. I'm very proud to be a Canadian citizen. Thank you again for your attention and your dedication to the study of things Canadian.
Because I believe that the students are back. Well, I guess I can just say a few words. The transmission of this opening session will be closed soon, but we wanted. I got an echo effect here, so I don't know. But we want the semifinalists not to disconnect, as there will be several technical issues discussed before we proceed to the essay writing. I would like to thank you, all the semifinalists and teachers, for participating in the contest, and particularly the students who engaged in the discussion with the ambassador of Canada to Poland. I reiterate that the organizing committee, both from the university and the Karol Miarka High School, a committee headed by Magister Hanna Mrozek, who's indefatigable in the promotion of Canadian studies at this high school. So we wish you, all of you, lots of success. And we are looking forward to seeing some of you in the final of this contest in April. Thank you very much again. We can close the transmission at the moment.